I'm starting out with some questions. So I want to ask you guys this, and this is the beginning. Let me start with a word of prayer and go from here. Lord, we rely on you, your Holy Spirit. I know that we're studying apologetics and we're kind of relying on, you know, finding evidence and reasons and logic and common sense, all that. But those are all gifts from you. And so we will use them as good stewards of everything that you give us. But at the same time, it's your Holy Spirit that we ultimately rely on, and just trust that you will guide us and guide our conversation and guide the study. This morning, we lift it up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. So, yeah, does God exist? I'm gonna read all three questions. I don't think we have to like respond to all three, but maybe respond to pick one of them and respond to it. Was there ever a time when you doubted God's existence? Maybe tell a little bit about that. Do you have any friends or relatives that say they don't believe God exists? And what is the difference between an atheist and an agnostic? So, any reactions to those questions?
Yeah, to explain the atheist and agnostic.
Yeah, have you heard those terms before?
Yeah, I heard terms.
Not quite sure. So an atheist basically says God does not exist. Some of them, well, if they say, well, I'm not sure, I believe God doesn't exist, but I'm not sure, or I don't know for sure, or I can't prove it, or whatever, they might be more in the category of an agnostic. So agnostic means without knowledge, or basically ignorant. But I like to tell people, you know, that is the most, if you don't have like a personal experience as far as like that drives your belief, I think being an agnostic and admitting ignorance is the most wisest way to go. It's like, you know, especially if you're not just content to stay there, if you're willing to ask questions and keep searching, being an agnostic is a wise thing. So it's basically someone who says, I don't know. I think there's two types of agnostics. I think there's those that say, I don't know and I want to know and I'm going to search. And then there's some that say, I don't know and I don't care. And so that's, you know, some people that's like their defense. They don't want to know if God exists, because if he does, then we're accountable to him, you know? So an atheist, the problem with atheism is they're basically saying God does not exist. And it's almost like saying there is no gold in China. Well, you'd have to go to China and look under every rock and be absolutely sure that there's no gold, you know, like, can you really say, like, does anyone have such vast knowledge of the universe that they know there is no God? You know, it's like, that's a pretty, pretty arrogant attitude to have, you know? So does that help? An atheist says there is no God. An agnostic says, I'm not sure. I don't know.
This question has come up quite often.
A lot of times people, you know, everyone wants to kind of put themselves in a category. Some people don't, but, and so people oftentimes identify themselves as atheists. And then I say, are you sure there's no God? And they say, well, no, I'm not sure. And so at least I want to help them realize they don't have to have such a absolute position that there is no God. You know, it's better, you know, I try to affirm the fact that, or the idea that we don't know. And maybe we can find out, you know, maybe we should keep searching since we don't know. So it does come up a lot because people try to put labels on themselves or others. Yeah. So, okay. So we'll move on. Just a few things. So is this on your sheet then, right? Okay. So if God does not exist, I believe we can't explain the existence of the universe. You know, God is the uncaused cause, you know, the whole law of cause and effect says everything has to be caused by something else. The only way that we can say that anything exists, to me, this is the most basic principle. This is why, even if I wasn't a Christian, I would have to say there is a creator. There is an uncaused cause that brought everything into existence. So without God, we can't explain the existence of the universe. We can't explain the origins of life. And so as scientists are discovering more and more about just what it is that causes life in the first place, you know, it's impossible. Even the most simple single-celled organism contains, you know, like a one-celled animal, one-celled form of life, contains interconnecting parts that all have to exist in place for it to be life and for it to be able to reproduce. And so it's so complex. It's beyond anything that could happen by random chance, even given trillions of years. So I believe it. Without God, we can't explain life. We can't explain morality. Without God saying what is right and what is wrong, we have no moral foundation. an atheist who doesn't believe in God, if they believe in, for example, evolution, what they're saying is the strong survive, and that's not a morality. If they say, well, I just base it on what I think to be true, then we're saying it's subjective. There's no morality. If someone else says, well, I think child molestation is a good thing, they would have no moral foundation to say, no, it's not, because that person, that's their morality. This is yours, you know. There would be no justice as far as there are ultimate consequences. We know that people in life, the wicked don't always get punished right away. People that commit murder don't always get caught. So without the idea that there is an afterlife and someone we're accountable to, there would be no sense of justice. We'd have no purpose. Why are we here? What are we doing? I talk to people that try to explain their purpose in life without God, and usually they just say, I just want, I want to be as happy as I can be and enjoy the days that I have, because this is all there is. But it's a self-centered, very self-centered purpose. Now, Christians are often criticized, or there's the claim made that we're being selfish because we just, we just want to go to heaven, right? And my answer to that is yes, because God is there. God is our focus. God is the reason for our existence, and He is the ultimate reward. And so if being with my Creator in a right relationship for eternity is my purpose in life, then so be it. It's about God. It's not about me.
Well, that would be the ultimate purpose of life. Then you have those who say, what is, Christians also, even myself, I don't know what that purpose is. What is my purpose in here?
Yeah.
So that question comes up a lot, more so than the
ultimate purpose. So the Bible is real clear that we exist, and actually all of God's creation exists for God's glory. So we're here to glorify God. And so we were created to live out all of our God-given gifts and talents in serving Him. And
you also have those questions, well, what is that? What the whole matter of purpose is, I am sitting here for what purpose?
Yeah.
And I agree. I'm not saying I agree.
Yeah.
I would say it is to give God glory and honor.
Yeah.
Because He is the Almighty. But people want us, especially, it's not so much young Christians. It's time Christians who've been in, the Word and studying and walking, and then all of a sudden it's like, their season of life has changed.
Mm-hmm.
And when that season changes, then they're looking for, well, what is my purpose here?
Well, without God, we absolutely have no purpose.
No.
People will say, I'm looking for my purpose in life.
Yeah.
And really, I believe they're looking for a way to justify their existence, because our conscience, our moral conscience, lets us know that we haven't fulfilled it. And, have we made it worth it that we're here? So can the Bible be God's word? If God doesn't exist, no, it can't, because how could it be God's word if there is no God? Can Jesus be God's son? Can we be with God for eternity? None of those things can happen. All right, so this is a little video on God's existence that I'm going to kind of base this study on. It's from godquestions.org, so I think it's pretty well done.
Does God exist? Is there evidence for the existence of God? The existence of God cannot be proved or disproved. The Bible says that we must accept by faith the fact that God exists. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him. Hebrews 11:6.
All right, so this is basically the what they just said. I just have the video form of it. So the Bible, basically, we can't prove, in a scientific method or a scientific way that God exists. Can't prove that He exists or doesn't exist. It can't be proved or disproven. It does say that we need to accept it by faith. So without faith, it's impossible to please God. So this is a passage from Hebrews 11:6. Hebrews 11 is that whole chapter about all the different people, mainly from the Old Testament, who trusted that God exists and that He will answer. For example, Abraham, He will answer or He will honor their faith. And a lot of them stepped out on faith and did things and didn't even see the answer to their acts of faith. And yet God did bring about the promises that He had given them. So faith is something that God wants us to have, and I believe there's a reason for that. If, you know, if everyone had a demand for God to prove himself to them in life, what we all 7 billion of us would have to have our own personal miracles probably happening every day. You know, we would be in the position of putting God to the test, and we would be in the place of God. So no, God is the one. We're in a relationship with our Creator on his terms, not on our own. And so much of that depends on faith. So we need to come to him. We need to believe that he exists, number one, but also, what is he like? We need to also believe that he rewards those who seek him. So I really believe we can reduce that down to, we need to believe that God is great, because if we believe God exists, that means we believe in a creator who made this great universe. He must be even greater than that. So we believe God is great and God is good. He's a rewarder when we seek after him. So I think there's a lot of theology in that children's prayer. God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for our food. Have you heard that? And it's based on this, I think it's based on this, or it can be found at least in this passage. God is great and God is good. He rewards us for seeking him. So what do you guys think is the difference between evidence and proof? Are they the same? Or I think a lot of times people think they're the same.
No. Evidence brings about proof.
Yeah. The one is part of the other. Proof is the ultimate, you know, conclusion. Evidence would be all those different things. And I think there's really very few things in life that fall in the category of proof, you know. Even the scientific theory of gravity, you know. Are we sure that there's no place in the universe that gravity doesn't apply? We don't know that. What's our evidence? Well, our evidence would be that everywhere we know of, it does apply. But so evidence, if someone says, I have evidence that God doesn't exist, you know, for example, how could he let the, you know, evil exist? That's my evidence. Well, that's not proof. That's just like maybe one fact. And I might have some evidence, you know, to counteract that. And so evidence can be for or against, and it's a whole body of evidence. And different people have different ideas of, you know, like skeptics have a real high standard for how much evidence they require. Bottom line, they don't want God to exist. And so they require so much evidence that it's impossible. But to say that, you know, proof and evidence, yeah, we can't prove much in life. Evidence, though, there is plenty of evidence for Christianity. And so our faith can incorporate that. Our faith can, that can be a part of our faith. So can the words of the Bible be considered to be evidence for God's existence? What do you guys think about that? If they say, someone says, prove God exists, and I say, well, look at the Bible. And they'll say, well, that, yeah, I don't want to give answers. What do you think? Do you think that could be evidence?
It's one of the evidence.
Yeah. So it's not proof.
No.
And that's okay. But it's one of the evidences. Can we imagine if God was to say, believe in me, and he didn't tell us what he was like? Or every generation has to experience God the same way? No, we learn from previous generations, and we know what God has done in the past, and so we can base our faith on that. And yeah, so if we didn't have the Bible, the fact that the Bible exists and shows God's actions throughout history is evidence. It's not proof, and I guess that's where we just have to say, like, can you imagine trying to believe in God without the Bible?
Yeah.
You know, everyone would have a different idea of what God is like.
But yeah, so. During the Genesis part, that's where people were. There wasn't the
yeah, Bible. And I do have to say, so in my theology class, we learned that God never changes, you know, but his revealing himself does change throughout time. We have a better idea of who God is and what he's all about than we do from the first couple chapters of Genesis. And so I think the best way to think about that, like how is it that God doesn't change and yet we learn so much more about him as time passes? And so it's more like the truth and the person of God doesn't change, but it unfolds. And so if you think about an origami, you know, something that's folded up piece of paper, everything about it is there, you just can't see it all. And so we unfold different parts of it and we learn more about it, but it never changed. It was there all the time. So part of the key is learning and trusting reliable people in the past.
Yes.
That's what the Bible's all about.
Yeah, that's where Hebrews comes from.
And learning from their experiences, you know, learning from their mistakes. The Bible is not about holy people doing holy things all the time. No, we see the mistakes they made. They try to avoid them. So the Bible's there is tons of evidence in the Bible. The whole, and I'll close on this. A lot of people will say, well, the Bible is circular reasoning. In other words, the Bible is God's word because it says it's God's word. How can that be? My pushback would be that the Bible is not just one book. It's many books. They're all interconnected. There's prophecies being fulfilled. There's a constantly unfolding revelation of God to the point where it's like everything contributes to the story. And so all the different books and authors of the Bible, even though God's the ultimate author, they all come together to provide a huge amount of evidence for God. And the more I read the Bible, even at this, you know, like after I've read it quite a bit, the more I'm convinced, you know, that this is no ordinary book or collection of books, that it's, you know, it's got God's fingerprint all over it. So
another evidence too is archaeology.
Yeah.
I mean, they have, where there is literally the writing on the wall.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Of evidence.
Yeah. So the Bible definitely is evidence for God.